Father, we come before thee, knee bent and body bowed, in the humblest way that we know how. Father who controls and knows all things, both the living and dying of all creatures, give us the strength and the wisdom to do thy work. In God's name we pray, and all of God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Son Pinty's right there in her hands.
She thought he was a wild animal.
And I saw Dionysus got his revenge.
You a heathen, Henry.
You know what I got right here?
What?
Some of that very wine.
When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, put away all childish things. Freshman class, I believe we are the most privileged people in America because we have the most important job in America, the education of our young people. Upon our young people that there will be difficulties that they face.
Come on, Trudell, come get this whooping, boy. Scared, ain't you? Huh? You're the raisin twice my size?
They must defeat them. They must do what they have to do in order to do what they want to do. Education is the only way out. The way out of ignorance.
Like cutting people, homeboy. Wanna cut people, Trudell, huh?
Get your hands off me. The way out of darkness. Into the glorious light.
Precious Hamilton.
This isn't funny. Come on, Dunbar, give it back. Who do you think you are, Jesse Owens? I am 20 profusely right now.
Have a seat.
I am the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes, but I laugh. And I eat well, and I grow strong. Tomorrow I'll sit at the table when company comes. Nobody'll dare say to me, eat in the kitchen then. Besides, they'll see how beautiful I am and be ashamed.
I, too, am America.
Who wrote that?
Langston Hughes, 1924.
1925. Hating you shall be a game played with cool hands. Memory will lay its hands upon your breast, and you will understand my hatred. Gwendolyn Bennett wrote that. She was born in 1902, unofficially. You see, in most states, Negroes were denied birth certificates, which means I can lie about my age the rest of my life. You think that's funny? To be born without record. Mr. Reed, hand these out. I'm going to introduce you to some new voices this semester. There's a revolution going on in the North, in Harlem. They're changing the way Negroes in America think. I'm talking about poets like Hughes, Bennett, Zora Neale Hurston, County Cullen. Some are teed on a silver spoon with the stars strung up for a rattle. I cut my teeth as a black raccoon.
For implements of battle.
Meet me after class.
What's a professor doing in the middle of the night, dressed like a cotton chopper?
What is a student doing in the middle of the night, throwing his life away?
It's funny, I thought I was defending myself. Mm.
I remember you. A couple of years ago, and you disappeared. What happened?
I come and go, whenever it suits me.
Suspensions?
Leaves of absence.
Why'd you come back?
School's the only place you can read all day. At prison.
I want you to come by my house tonight, 7:30, corner of Junior Campus.
Why would I do that?
Holding tryouts for the debate team.
You sure you want somebody like me?
No. That's why you're trying out. 7:30, Junior Campus.
Driven by the wind and tossed. Do well tonight, Junior.
Of the 360 students here at Wiley College, only 45 of you were brave enough to try out for the debate team. Of that 45, only 4 of you will remain standing when the tryouts are over. Why? Because debate is blood sport. It's combat. But your weapons are words. Come on in. Now that Mr. Farmer has joined us, we can begin. Sit down, Mr. Farmer. Not right there. Over there.
Yes, sir. Okay, right this way.
Good evening, Miss Tolson.
Evening.
Excuse me.
We're waiting for you, Mr. Farmer.
I'm going, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Farmer. You smell very good, Mr. Farmer.
Thank you, sir.
You're very welcome. Gentlemen and lady, this is the hot spot. You will enter it at your own risk.
Mr. Tolson, what about the debaters from last
Don't year? Ask a question you already know the answer to. Get up here. You'll be first. Get right here. Hot spot. Debate starts with a proposition, with an idea, resolved. Child labor should be regulated by the federal government.
The first debater argues the affirmative. Affirmative means that you are for something. Mr. Reed will argue the affirmative. The second debater argues the negative. Negative means that you are what?
Against.
Brilliant, Mr. Burgess. You shall argue the affirmative, Mr. Reed. Go.
Well, sir, I'd begin with a quote from the poet Cleghorn. The golf links lie so near the mill that almost every day the laboring children can look out and
watch the men at play.
Is that what you learned from last year, Mr. Reed? To start something and not finish it? Is it?
No, sir.
Sit down. Who's next? You? Stand up. Stand up. It's getting late. How much longer can you hide?
I'm not hiding, sir. I transferred from my college just to come here and try out for you.
I'm deeply moved. What's your name?
Samantha Book.
Book?
With an E.
Arise, Miss Book. With an E. Enter the hot spot, Miss Book. With an E.
You know, there's never been a female on the debating team, ever.
Yes, sir, I know that.
What makes you think you should be the first?
Because, sir, I am just as qualified as anybody else here. My gender
Resolve.
Has nothing.
Welfare discourages hard work. You'll argue the negative.
All right.
Welfare takes away a man's strongest reason for working, which is survival. And that weakens the will of the poor. How would you rebut that, Miss Book, with an E?
I would say it does not. Most of the New Deal goes to children anyway, and to the handicapped, and to old people.
Is that fact or conjecture?
It is a fact.
Speak up.
It is a fact.
What's your source?
The President.
Of the United States?
Yes, sir.
That's your primary source. You spoke to President Roosevelt personally.
Of course not. I did not speak to him personally, but I listened to his fireside chat.
Ah, a radio broadcast.
Yes.
Any other sources? Any other sources?
Yes, there are other sources. Like that look in a mother's eyes when she can't feed her kids. Without welfare, Mr. Tolson, people would be starving.
Who's starving, Miss Book?
The unemployed are starving.
Mr. Burgess here, he's unemployed. Obviously, he's not starving. I drew you in, Miss Book. You gave a faulty premise, so your syllogism fell apart.
Syllogism?
Your logic fell apart. Major premise, the unemployed are starving. Minor premise, Mr. Burgess is unemployed. Conclusion, Mr. Burgess is starving. Your major premise was based on a faulty assumption. Classic fallacy. Who's next?
You're right.
Tell us your name.
I'm Henry Lowe, with an E.
All right, Mr. Lowe. I will name a subject. You speak a few words, a pertinent quote from world literature.
Go ahead.
Beauty.
I heard the old men say, all that is beautiful drifts away like the waters.
Very good. History. And name the author this time.
History is a nightmare from which I'm trying to awake. James Joyce.
Self-pity.
I never saw a wild thing sorry for itself. D.H. Lawrence.
I love D.H. Lawrence. Have you ever read...
Mr. Farmer.
Yes, sir.
I have eyes in the back of my head and ears on both sides. Stand up. Tell me the irony in the name Bethlehem Steel Corporation.
Bethlehem is the birthplace of Jesus, Prince of Peace, and Bethlehem Steel makes weapons of war.
Very good. Sit down. Who's next?
Samantha. Samantha. This Tulsa's tough, isn't he?
He sure is.
James.
Is your father Dr. James Farmer?
Yes. Yes, he is.
I'm taking theology from him, and that man speaks in tongues.
French, Greek, Hebrew, Latin.
How many languages does he speak?
Seven languages.
He must be the smartest man in Texas.
Well, that's not saying much. So why do you want to be on the team?
I think it'd be good training.
For what?
Being a lawyer.
Lawyer?
Yeah.
It's great.
You know how many Negro women practice law in this state?
Two.
Exactly.
One of them's my aunt.
Well, look at you, Mr. Farmer. How old are you anyway?
I'll be 16. In 21 months.
Young lady.
James,
I just wanted to thank you.
For what?
Well, for your performance tonight. I mean, how many other students ever stand up to Tulsa?
I did.
No, you answered a question and I spouted a few quotes. Miss Book, with an E. She fought back.
And lost.
But you didn't have to lose. Why isn't a fireside chat a legitimate source? Because Tolson said so? Nobody has better access to those statistics than the president. Now, if you'd have called Tolson on that, you would have won.
I don't know. I'm sure that man would have come up with something. Good night, James.
Can you believe he's 14 years old and he's in college?
You are gifted, all of you. So I want you to know that I chose this team for balance, and none of you should take it as a failure. As a denigration of your intellect. Denigrate, there's a word for you. From the Latin word niger, to defame, to blacken, it's always there, isn't it? Even in the dictionary. Even in the speech of a Negro professor. Somehow, black is always equated with failure. Well, write your own dictionary. And mark this as a new beginning. Whether you make the team or not. The Wiley College Forensic Society of 1935-1936 is as follows. The debaters will be Mr. Hamilton Burgess from last year's team. Sit down, Mr. Burgess. Mr. Henry Lowe. Our alternates. Miss Samantha Book with an E. And finally,
down.
Where's that?
Quiet. He's writing a lecture.
Dad.
Junior, what is the greatest weakness of man?
Not believing? Doubt?
That's it. Thank you, Junior. Matthew 14:31.
That will be the lesson.
Dad.
Oh, you of little faith. Why? Do you doubt?
Dad?
What is it, son?
I made the debate team.
Well, congratulations. And who is on your team?
There's four of us. I'm one of the alternates.
Who's ahead of you?
Hamilton Burgess and Henry Lowe. And the other alternate, Samantha Book.
There's a girl?
She wants to be a lawyer.
Lawyer?
She's very intelligent.
She pretty?
I don't know. I never really noticed.
Those extracurricular activities like the debate team are fine, but you must not take your eye off the ball, son.
Yes, sir.
So, what do we do here?
We do what we have to do so we can do what we want to do.
What do you have to do right now?
My homework.
To get to it?
Yes, sir.
Has apples, bananas, cookies, donuts, eggs, figs, and gonzola beans.
Right. What's gonzola, gonzola beans?
Hogwash!
Gonzola
beans?
Yeah. Apricots. What, no apricots?
Who's that?
Pig.
pee.
Shut up, dog.
Junior, get in the car.
What the hell happened to my hog?
Sorry about that. Came out of nowhere. I didn't see it coming.
You done killed my hog, boy.
Truly sorry. Gladly pay you for it. How much you want?
It's gonna cost you $25.
I only have a few bucks on me right now, but I can... I do have a check. My monthly check for Wiley College in Marshall. It's for $17.36. You may have that. I will endorse that over to you.
You do what?
I will sign the check over to you.
Well, let me see it.
It's in the car with my wife. I'm gonna walk to the car now. Junior, get in the car. Give me that salary check, girl.
We need that money, James.
Just give me the check. Go.
I thought it was in here.
Relax, it's all right. It's in here. You're fine.
Check better be good, boy.
It's good.
Well, pick it up. Whoa, where the hell you think you're going? You gotta help us get this hog in my truck.
Come on, grab the tail end of that, boy.
All right, on three.
One, two, three. Get it down, niggas. You did too good to get the hands dirty.
You to do something, Junior. You do it.
Who's the judge?
The judge is God.
Why is he God?
Because he decides to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who is your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
Why does he not exist?
He's merely to enforce the truth I speak.
Who's the judge?
The judge is God.
Why is he God?
Because he
decides
to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who is your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
Why doesn't he exist?
Because he is merely a decision for the truth I speak.
Who's the judge?
The judge is God.
Why is he God?
Because he decides to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who is your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
Why does he not exist?
Because he is merely a decision for the truth I speak.
Who's the judge?
The judge is God.
How then?
The judge is God.
Why is he God?
Because he is God to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who's your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
Why does he not exist?
Because he is merely a decision for the truth I speak.
Speak the truth?
Speak the truth.
Yes, sir, I do like to talk.
Is that a virtue or a vice?
Well, I have to admit, I've always wanted to be the quiet, mysterious type. Only I couldn't keep my mouth shut long enough.
Would you punch yourself in a street fight, Mr. Burgess?
No, sir.
Then don't punch yourself in a word fight. You don't have to make fun of yourself. Use your humor against your opponent. Mr. Farmer.
Yes, sir.
Happy Mr. Farmer. Tell us one thing we don't know about your father.
He was the first Negro PhD.
One thing we don't know about your father, Mr. Farmer.
He walked from Florida to Massachusetts to go to college at Boston University. He graduated magna cum laude.
Mr. Lowe. Tell us about your father.
Why don't you tell us something about your father?
We're trying to get to know each other, Mr. Lowe.
I was trying to get to know you, Mr. Tolson.
Well, I'm not the one on the debate team.
Are we not engaged in a debate right now?
All right. I'll take the affirmative. Take the meanest, most restless nigger. Strip him of his clothes in front of the remaining male niggers, female niggers, and nigger infants. Tar and feather him. Tie each leg to a horse facing an opposite direction, set him on fire, and beat both horses until they tear him apart in front of the male, female, and nigger infants. Bullwhip and beat the remaining nigger males within an inch of their life. Do not kill them, but put the fear of God in them, for they can be useful for future breeding. Anybody know who Willie Lynch was? Anybody? Raise your hand. No one? He was a vicious slave owner in the West Indies. The slave masters in the colony of Virginia were having trouble controlling their slaves, so they sent for Mr. Lynch to teach them his methods. The word lynching came from his last name. His methods were very simple, but they were diabolical. Keep the slave physically strong, but psychologically weak and dependent on the slave master. Keep the body, take the mind. I and every other professor on this campus are here to help you to find, take back, and keep your righteous mind. Because obviously, you have lost it. That's all you need to know about me, Mr. Lowe. Class dismissed.
Me some punch.
Yeah, you don't mind, you want.
Let's go.
All right? You know I could take you to a place that plays real music, right?
I'm not leaving here, Henry.
Just for a spell, I'll bring you right back.
And what would my chaperone say?
We'll be back before she ever knows you're gone. What's the matter, you're afraid?
What's the matter? You afraid?
Mr. Tolson?
Them too.
Yeah, so they can shoot us all down, white colored and mixed.
That's exactly what they want you to believe. The farm bosses want you to believe that they'll make war. They won't. They may be fools, but they're smart businessmen. And once we're organized, they'll see. Even guns can't stop us.
Stomped them in a lane.
But why don't you talk about that? About how they killed 100 colored sharecroppers for trying to organize.
That was 1919, friend.
And that was my daddy they gunned down, friend.
We're sorry about that. But those men stood alone. That's my point. This is 1935. We got the National Labor Relations Board. We got the AFL-CIO.
You ain't got shit. He ain't got shit.
Oh, God.
What are you doing out here? Huh?
I saw you. I was walking by your house, and I saw you dressed funny.
I'm dressed like them, son. You think they'd listen to me if I was wearing a tuxedo? Huh?
No, sir.
Listen to me. You listening? You cannot tell anybody what you saw tonight. You understand? Not even my wife knows about this.
I won't tell anybody, I promise. I promise on a stack of Bibles, I won't tell anybody.
June, are you just gonna stand there?
No, sir. Sorry, I'm late.
You sorry? It's 1 o'clock in the morning. I've been looking everywhere for you.
I went to Mr. Tolson's house after the dance.
Thought you might have done that. That's why I went over there. And I talked to Ruth. She said Tolson was gone and that you weren't there. So I'm gonna give you another chance. Where were you?
I can't tell you, sir.
Good Lord, boy. We've been worried to death about you.
Junior? Where were you?
I can't tell you, sir.
Why not?
I don't know.
I don't know. I don't know is not an acceptable answer, Junior.
Junior.
Silence is not an option either. So, you've been drinking?
Honey.
Because you must have been drinking coming
honey,
up in my house.
Honey.
Talking about you don't want to tell me where you've been at 1:30 in the morning?
Come on, baby, tell me. What's the matter?
Mom, nothing's the matter.
No, something is the matter. Something is wrong. Well, you with that girl.
No.
Because you're 14 years old, Junior. You got plenty of time for girls later.
I wasn't with Samantha.
Junior.
Then where were you?
Where were you, honey?
You don't want to talk? Fine. But you're not leaving this house.
What do you mean?
Just what I said. You're not leaving this house until you tell me the truth.
What about school?
Don't go questioning what I just said, boy.
Mom, what about
school? And don't raise your voice.
I'm not raising my voice.
You gonna go raising your voice in the house?
I'm not raising my voice.
You get a job, pay your own way, you man.
I'm not raising my voice.
Just apologize.
I didn't say anything. Why should I apologize? Like you apologize to that pig farmer.
Boy. You go to your room.
Junior.
I'm not going to be weak on this, Pearl.
I know.
Can't allow my son to be corrupt.
You're right. Let's just go to bed. I'll take him to school.
I'm gonna be honest with you boys. I'm not well. I'm not well at all this morning.
I'm sure sorry to hear that, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you look well to me. Don't you look well, sir?
Yes, sir. You look real good.
Now, we got some white fellas from up north come into our town. They're stirring up trouble between our colors and our whites. They say that we need to make a union. The sharecroppers and the workers all together, colored and white. They need to make a union. How you boys feel about that?
I don't
No, sir, I really ain't thought much about that.
Well, it's a bad idea. It's a bad idea, take my word for it.
Yes, sir.
And they say that there was some kind of secret meeting last night down near the lake. Now, do you boys know about that?
No, sir.
You don't know about that? Samuel?
No, sir.
You didn't hear about that?
No, sir.
You swear to me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I swear.
Well, all right, then. See you later.
Our first debate is 1 week from today.
1 week?
That's right.
I thought Prairie View was first.
Prairie View is tough, so I thought we needed a warm-up.
With the best Negro college in the state?
That's right, Mr. Burgess. Does that frighten you?
Yes, sir.
1 week's not enough time to write our arguments.
You do the research, I'll write the arguments.
Wait, you? You write the arguments.
And you deliver them, Mr. Lowe.
What the hell do I look like, a mailman?
Hell is where you're headed if you question me again. In theory, you look like a student.
So what you're saying is I'm not capable.
It's not a matter of competence. It's a matter of experience.
Well, how do I know you write
that enough? I write the arguments. That's the way it's been. That's the way it's going to be. Any more questions? 1 week.
I bring to you our first affirmative debater from Paul Quinn College, Oakley Hubbard.
Resolved. Unemployment relief should be ended when the Depression ends.
If the Depression ends.
I traveled back through history to 1536, when the first poor laws of England were mandated. In those days, the dole, or welfare as we call it, was funded by voluntary contributions. But as time passed, the English devised the allowance system, the first unemployment relief. Only now it was paid with involuntary contributions, more commonly known as taxes. The allowance system was a disaster. The only real unemployment relief is to give a man a job. But to do that, you have to give the economy life, not tax it to death.
When capitalism was young, the old puritanical concept of duty was, he who does not work shall not eat. Now that made sense when it was more work than men willing to do it, but those days are gone. Now there are millions who want to work, but find themselves standing in bread lines. Now should they not eat because there are no jobs? People, today we need a new concept of duty. The right of the individual to demand from society just as much as he gives to society.
We clutch at anything that even looks like a solution. $60 million a month for public relief. Pay it out. If it'll sweep the hobos off the streets, 1/7 of the population of the United States on welfare. Fine, as long as it ends our misery. A nation as desperate as this is a danger to itself.
Once, a Roman general brought peace to a rebellious province by killing all its citizens. Even his fellow Romans were shocked. One of them wrote, "Solitudinem faciunt, pacem appellant," which means they create desolation and call it peace. Now, for all their facts and figures, the Paul Quinn debaters would also create desolation and call it peace. They would allow the unemployed to die so the economy can live. A brilliant young woman I know was asked once to support her argument in favor of social welfare. She named the most powerful source imaginable, the look in a mother's face when she cannot feed her children. Can you look that hungry child in the eyes? See the blood on his feet from walking barefoot in the cotton fields? Or do you ask his baby sister with her belly swollen from hunger if she cares about her daddy's work ethic?
Oh!
He's good.
Me, but you don't know more. You gotta step it up and go, yeah.
Thinking it's the best vitamin. Yeah, only thing that matters is that big fishy little fish and the color of the fish does not step count. Up and go.
Got a little
the state of Mississippi would have turned their heads each and every time a Negro was lynched. Shouldn't the federal government intervene?
Yeah, go. Well, you can't stand pat, I pray. You gotta step it up and go. Shut, back door too, blind pull down, what you gonna do? You gotta step it up and go, and go. We can't stand pat, I clear, you gotta step it up and go. Got a little girl, her name is Ball, give a little bit, but she took it all. You gotta step it up and go, and go.
And the winner
we
is...
Can't stand pat, I step it up and go, yeah.
Wiley Collins.
Me and my baby walking down the street, telling everybody about the chief of police. You gotta step it up and go, and go. Well, you can't stand pat, I clear, you gotta step it up and go. See my woman, tell her hurry home. Ain't had no loving since she been gone. You gotta step it up and go. Step it up and go. When I sing this verse, ain't gonna sing no more. Hear my girl call, I got...
That's right, Captain. I think I got the ringleader. All right, if that's what you want. Yeah, okie dokie then. Bye-bye. Shit.
Who is that?
Captain Wainwright.
Texas Rangers?
Mm-hmm. He wants me to hold off on picking this fella up until him and his boys get up here.
Shit. Wants to get his picture in the paper.
Yeah. We do all the work. They get all the glory.
Yeah.
Guess that's just the way the world is. Isn't that right, Samuel?
I have an announcement to make. Excuse me. Recently, we sent some letters to some major universities, told them all about us, our team, what we've been doing. And yesterday, we got a response from Oklahoma City University.
Aren't they
Anglo-Saxon? Yes. Oh. Yes. It'll be the first Negro college in America. Well, one of the first Negro colleges in America to ever debate a white college.
All right. University of Oklahoma.
Not University of Oklahoma, Oklahoma City University. Oh. The debate will take place at an off-campus site.
Wait, an off-campus site? Why?
Because sometimes, Mr. Lowe, you have to take things one step at a time.
Oh, so what you're saying is that the crackers in Oklahoma ain't gonna let us
no,
on the campus.
No, what I'm saying is you have to take things one step at a time.
This is a great opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Yes, great opportunity.
Master just done on our... Give us a crumb off his plate, huh? What?
I think Lowe here is afraid.
What am I afraid of, James?
I think you're afraid to debate white people.
Anglo-Saxon.
Anglo-Saxon.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Tolson, let me debate. I mean, I'll debate Anglo-Saxons anywhere. In a dark alley with no light, with a candle lit and people chasing you down with guns. No, I'll debate Anglo-Saxons anywhere. I ain't afraid.
I am. Mr. Tolson, when I came here today, I saw the sheriff outside watching your house. What's going on?
Maybe you should ask the sheriff.
Been hearing a lot of rumors about what you're doing. My dad just called the dean last week and asked, what is a communist doing teaching at a good Methodist college?
My politics are my business, Mr. Burgess, and I promise you that they will not endanger the team.
But sir, it is being endangered. I came to Wiley College to be educated, not investigated.
I understand that.
I don't want to be dragged into anything. If my parents want... I'm sorry. Mr. Tolson, please. Just tell me you're not a communist, otherwise.
Otherwise what? Otherwise what?
My father says I have to quit.
Nobody wants that.
Then tell me.
As I said, my politics are my business.
Well, I guess I have to resign. Mrs. Tolson, thank you for a wonderful dinner.
You're welcome, ma'am.
Good luck in Oklahoma, y'all. I know you'll win.
Else wants to quit, I'll understand.
Resolved. Negroes should be admitted.
I can't hear you.
Resolved. Negroes should be admitted to state universities. My partner and I will prove that blocking a Negro's admission to a state university is not only wrong, it is absurd. The Negro people are not just a color in the American fabric. They are the thread that holds it all together. Consider the legal and historical record. May 13, 1865, Sergeant Crocker, a Negro, is the last soldier to die in the Civil War. 1918, the first U.S. soldiers decorated for bravery in France are Negroes, Henry Johnson, and Needham Roberts. 1920, the New York Times announces that the N in Negro would hereafter be capitalized.
Force upon the South, what they are not ready for, would result in nothing but more racial hatred. Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, he's perhaps the most eminent Negro scholar in America. He comments, "It's a silly waste of money, time, and temper to try and compel a powerful majority to do what they are determined not to do."
My opponent so conveniently chose to ignore the fact that W.E.B. Du Bois is the first Negro to receive a Ph.D. from a white college
called Harvard. Dr. Du Bois, he adds, "It is impossible, impossible for a Negro to receive a proper education at a white college."
The most eminent Negro scholar in America is the product of an Ivy League education. You see, Du Bois knows all too well the white man's resistance to change. But that's no reason to keep a black man out of any college. If someone didn't force upon the South something it wasn't ready for, I'd still be in chains and this book here be running for my own massa.
I do admit it. It is true. Far too many whites are afflicted with the disease of racial hatred. And because of racism, it would be impossible for a Negro to be happy at a Southern white college today. And if someone is unhappy, it is impossible to see how they could receive a proper education. Yes, a time will come when Negroes and whites will walk on the same campus and we will share the same classrooms. But sadly, that day is not today.
As long as schools are segregated, Negroes will receive an education that is both separate and unequal. By Oklahoma's own reckoning, the state is currently spending 5 times more for the education of a white child than it is spending to educate a colored child. That means better textbooks for that child than for that child. Oh, I say that's a shame, but my opponent says today is not the day for whites and coloreds to go to the same college, to share the same campus, to walk in the same classroom. Well, would you kindly tell me, when is that day gonna come? Is it gonna come tomorrow? Is it gonna come next week? In 100 years? Never? No, the time for justice, the time for freedom, and the time for equality is always right now.
What is this?
Told you it's holy wine. Put hair on your chest.
If you say so.
Good, ain't
it? Uh-huh.
You know where the bathroom is if you need it.
Yeah.
And my weapons were words. I didn't need a gun. I didn't need a knife. You see?
Meet me outside in 5 minutes.
And then what?
Yes, I did, honey. Nobody knows that better than you.
No, I'm fine. I'm fine. How you doing, Pearl?
Help me.
Yes, I do. Where's your husband?
He's in the study.
Okay. All right, then. Dr. Farmer.
Congratulations, Milton.
Thank you.
You have put us on the map.
Well, your son is doing a great job. His research is impeccable.
That's good to hear. That's good to hear. Listen, there are people around town who aren't very happy with your off-campus activities. They're calling you a radical. In fact, I wouldn't be a bit surprised to find out one morning when I woke up that you were strung up to a tree.
They'd have to catch me first.
It's serious, Milton. Very serious.
A hungry Negro steals a chicken, he goes to jail. A rich businessman steals bonds, he goes to Congress. I think that's wrong. Now, if that makes me a radical, a socialist, a communist,
amen.
So
amen
be it.
Amen on that.
Jesus was a radical.
Careful.
Yes, he was.
Careful.
Jesus was a radical.
Mental institutions are filled with people who have confused themselves with Jesus Christ.
I'm not confused.
Oh, you convinced you Jesus Christ now? You convinced you Jesus Christ?
Oh,
you know what words do.
Okay.
Come on now.
Amen.
Don't want to confuse yourself with
no,
Jesus Christ.
I'm not confused. I'm convinced.
I'm not judging you. I'm just concerned about your methods.
What methods?
James was there that night, wasn't he?
He was not with me.
Is he involved with this?
Of course not, James. I've done everything in my power to keep him out of this.
To keep him out?
Yes.
What, does he want to be involved? You telling me he wants to
no,
be involved?
No, he doesn't. Maybe this is something you should discuss with him.
I'm discussing it with you right now, and I don't feel like I'm getting a straight answer
from
you.
No, you're getting a straight answer.
I think that you were there with him that night.
He was not with me.
He's a 14-year-old boy.
I understand that, James.
And I'll do whatever I have to do to protect him. You understand that, don't you?
Anybody thirsty?
Here you are.
Thank you. Thank you,
Ruth. You're welcome.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Ruth, this is a fine party.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I think it's time for some sweet potato pie.
Please.
Well, I'll help you with that.
Not the time to talk about it. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So
so beautiful out here.
Yeah. I was born near here, a little further up the lake near Jefferson. I've come here since I was a little boy.
Your parents still live around here?
No, yeah. They're gone. My grandparents raised me. And my papa, he spent his life building the levees around here, for free, of course.
Mm. He was a slave.
Mm-hmm. And Grandma was always telling me to be good, or else the Confederates would rise up out of Marshall Cemetery and get me. What?
I just never seen a side of you before.
What side?
You seem so calm, so peaceful.
What the lake does to me. I'm happy when I'm out here, you know. And it's funny. Part of me wants to just stay out here by the lake, you know. Read books all day, hunt and fish when I get hungry. And the other part wants to go everywhere, you know, see everything. I want to go to New Orleans and New York and Chicago and even San Francisco. Just want to go walking down the road and just disappear.
Well, maybe you could take me with you.
Outside.
What? Oh, Jesus! I thought you said nobody ever
comes. Nobody ever does come here, Samantha. Hold on.
Eric! Get dressed.
What's going on?
We're gonna go get Mr. Tolson and Samantha, head back to the campus, and have a pep rally. Come on, get dressed.
You know, you go get Tolson and I'll meet up with y'all later on campus.
Come on, Lo. You're always gonna be fun. So I'll tell him you're gonna join us later. He's gonna join us later. Just has to clean his house.
news, great news, great news! My phone has been ringing off the hook. University of Michigan wants to debate us. So does SMU, so does Georgia. Where's Mr. Lowe?
When do I get to debate?
Sooner than you think, James. Sooner than you think.
When?
When you're ready.
Well, I'm ready now.
Mr. Tolson, I do not mind it, James.
What's wrong?
Maybe I'm tired of this.
Of what?
Of watching other people debate. When am I going to get a chance to prove myself?
You're our best researcher, James. We could not do this without
you. Oh, you do plenty without me.
Excuse me. James!
What?
James, you wait! That was so mean what you said in there. I don't want to lose your friend.
How can you lose something that you never had?
You were never my friend.
Maybe I don't want to just be your friend. Maybe it hurts me to be your friend.
Have you seen him?
No, they won't let us.
They ain't do nothing to you, did they?
No, we're fine.
Deputy, I'm Dr. James Farmer, Wiley College. This is William Taylor, Mr. Tolson's attorney, and this is his wife, Ruth.
Hello.
I'd like to see my client, please.
William!
Chef Dolce, Dr. James Farmer, William. This is William.
How you doing today?
Fine, sir, thank you. And you?
Oh, not too bad, not too bad. Me and William, we go way back. I knew William when I was a boy.
Could I see my client now, Sheriff?
Your client? Well, the fact of the business is, William, your client is kind of busy right now.
Busy doing what?
Sheriff. Sheriff.
Get some of these boys out there.
All right, man.
You?
That's right.
See, this is what happens to a town when you let the unions in. Starts trouble. People get all riled up about nothing. One of them's liable to get hurt if you catch my drift.
Sheriff, since it's clear that you have no evidence to arrest Mr. Tolson, I suggest you let him go.
You suggest it? Well, who the hell are you?
A couple of months ago, there was a raid on Floyd Tillman's barn. It was a peaceful and lawful gathering of sharecroppers who were brutally attacked by a gang of violent vigilantes. Now, witnesses say that you were there. If you led that raid, Sheriff, you're the one who broke the law, not Tolson.
Are you threatening me, boy?
No, sir. I wouldn't do that. But I cannot speak for those people outside. An unjust law is no law at all.
What does that mean?
A mass slaughter? Citizens? Both white and colored by Texas Rangers? Is that really what you want as a sheriff of this county? Now, if you let Tolson go home, I believe that these folks outside, they'll go home as well.
Pig wasn't worth $25.
What?
You owe my father some money.
see, Mr. Farmer.
Oh, Lord. SMU has canceled. University of Georgia, sounds like they will follow suit.
Why?
I've been blacklisted. They're talking about censuring me. Dean Clay and the board have asked me to stop working with the sharecroppers, or else they say that it is not my fight. So, things are bad. My academic career is in jeopardy. My debate team has nowhere to go. Anyone know who Antaeus was?
Sure, he was a gigantic wrestler in Greek mythology. His mother was Gia, the goddess of Earth. And, I mean, he was unbeatable because anytime someone threw him down to the Earth, it would make him stronger.
That's correct. It would make him stronger. Defeat would make him stronger. You are my students. I am your teacher. I think that's a sacred trust. So what do I say to you now? Quit? Because the dean says so? Because the sheriff says so? Because the Texas Rangers say so? No. I am diametrically opposed to that. My message to you is to never quit.
We are not quitting.
Good.
What do you want us to do?
Debate Harvard.
Harvard?
Harvard University. They're the reigning national champions. If we defeat them, we defeat the best.
Mr. Tolson, sir, with all due respect, Harvard ain't gonna debate us. Not little old Wiley College in Marshall, Texas.
They know who we are, Henry. I've been writing them letters, sending them articles.
But how do we get a letter back?
By continuing to win. Dr. Farmer has informed me that Howard University is going to be at Prairie View next week. We annihilated Fisk. If we eliminate Howard, we will have beaten the two best Negro colleges in America, and I can guarantee you that I will see to it that Harvard does not ignore that. All right?
Yeah.
You got a cute little cute. Oh, baby, one cute little cute. Come on, mama, it's cute little cute. Cute little cute little cute.
Just look for it on there. You see it on there?
I've been looking the whole
Prairie
time.
Prairie View, Texas. Look for 127.
You'd show me where to look, because it's not on.
127, near Waxahachie.
It's not there.
It's there. You just can't find it.
I see two and I see seven.
Right. Now, look for a one in front of it and you got it. After 126, okay. Before 128.
I really don't think.
You don't see it.
Where'd you get this map?
Sit tight and I'll get the keys.
Henry.
Baby, how you doing? You still up? You waiting on me? Well, what's the matter, baby? Come on. Baby. Come here.
Shut up. Let's go.
Hey, it's the boy.
Shut up. Let's go. Got him, Miss Tolson.
There go run, devil's town. Devil knock my daddy down. Run, nigga, run. I soon kiss you, run.
Okay, just sit. Not that bit. Look, get up.
Come here. Come here. Look down yonder, what I see? Great big nigga hanging in the tree. Run, nigga, run.
Worthless.
What?
You think you're the only one hurting?
Okay, I'm sorry for everything. For drinking, yeah. I apologize.
I'm not talking about me.
All right. I'm gonna go talk to her.
No, no, you won't, love. She doesn't need to see you like this, okay?
No, it's okay. I'm just gonna talk to her. Tell her to leave me alone.
No.
First, calm down, boy! Stop! Stop! I'm not playing with you. Calm down! You crazy? You're never gonna forget what you saw out there, do you understand? You're never gonna forget what you saw out there. You can hang the easiest part of it sometimes. Sometimes they cut your little fingers off. Your toes, your nose, your ears. Sometimes they cut your privates off. Sometimes they skin you alive. You'll never be able to forget.
What do you think he did?
He didn't have to do nothing, James! He didn't have to do nothing! In Texas, they lynch Negroes! Do you understand?
So it doesn't matter how good we are, does it?
What are you talking... What?
This is all useless.
What are you talking about?
I mean, we're just a bunch of Negroes debating each other on subjects we all agree on.
No, 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 James, don't talk like that, all right?
Why not?
Because you can't! Not you.
Where's Samantha?
She's not going with us.
Why not?
Why do you think? I took her to the bus station. She wanted to go back to school. You wanted your chance. This is it.
But how can any Negro defend the punishment of prison when he's seen so much oppression in his own life? How? Because crime itself is a form of oppression. And Negroes fall victim to more violent crime than any other race in America. For us, prison not only offers protection, but retribution. And for the criminal, it is a dark gift. The hardship that introduces a man to himself, that rouses his passion for freedom, his hope for redemption.
Our next debater from Wiley College, Mr. James Farmer Jr. Mr. Farmer.
Sorry. This game.
Harvard. What is this?
Go on and open it and read it.
Looks like somebody opened it already.
Not me.
You didn't open it already?
No.
You are not a good liar.
Out loud.
Dear Mr. Tolson, thank you for informing us about your historic victory over Oklahoma City. I'm sure you realize our season is nearly over, but today we received another letter from Wiley College written by Mr. Henry Lowe.
Mm-hmm.
With an E. He told us from a student's perspective about your about your undefeated season. Well, we're not undefeated anymore.
Don't matter.
I wish to extend an invitation to debate Harvard Crimson here in Cambridge. Let us know if this is agreeable to you.
Honey.
Don't you tell anybody.
No.
you don't have to thank me. Just wanted to show you I could write, too.
That's good. Thank you.
But you could do me a favor.
What's that?
And keep Samantha on the team.
Why would I do that?
Mr. Tolson, it was a rough night.
Yes, it was, Mr. Lowe. For all of us. And she walked out on us at the last minute.
No, sir, she did not walk out on us. She walked out on me.
It's good tea. Resolved. Capitalism is immoral. We will be arguing the affirmative.
To a bunch of Wall Street bankers.
Mr. Tolson, I owe you and my team a...
You're late. Come in. Sit down. Resolved.
Hey, you got macaroni and cheese, fried chicken, black-eyed peas for good luck, red beans and rice, cornbread, candied yams. I put some peach cobbler in there, too. And some bread pudding. I know you don't like bread pudding, but I put it in there anyway.
Thank you, Mom.
Good luck, son.
Dad?
Yes, June. You give Boston my regards. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Jay! Come on, train's leaving.
Coming!
Bye, Mom. Bye-bye. Bye, sis.
Love you.
Love you
too. I'm not going with you.
What?
I cannot leave the state. It's a condition of my bail.
Can't let them stop you.
They're not stopping me. I just don't want to jeopardize your opportunity. You can win without me. This is what you wanted to do all along, isn't it?
He's right.
Why didn't you tell us this before?
Because I didn't want to hear your arguments. I knew they'd be too good. All right, Mr. Lowe, you're in charge. Whatever your instincts tell you, you listen.
Yes, sir.
Let's go.
Supposed to do without you?
When?
Tell somebody who's supposed to meet us.
All passengers on the platform, please have your tickets ready.
Wiley College?
Yes.
I'm Harlan Osborne. Harvard has put me in charge of you for the time that you'll be here in Boston.
No, you don't. I'm Henry Lowe.
Mr. Lowe? It's
James Farmer, Jr.
Mr. Farmer?
Samantha Book.
Of course, Miss Book. But we should be going. My car's out front.
I've got it.
Oh, thank you.
Just so you know, you'll be staying on campus at Douglas Hall. I've got to tell you, this debate is stirring up a lot of excitement.
Really?
Oh, yeah. It's going to be broadcast all over America.
Can we see what we're going to debate?
Of course.
Excuse me. You supposed to be here?
I guess we'll find out, won't we?
$5? Lo, I got $5.
Yeah, I did too. It's called per diem.
Ooh.
You want me to hold it for you?
No, not my $5.
I got $5. I got $5.
Me too.
Well, mine is crispy. James, this is high tea. All right, we nibble, we do not devour.
How do you know?
I don't.
Hello, I'm Wilson. This is for you.
Thank you.
I can't accept that, sir. It would be inappropriate.
To be inappropriate.
Who's it from?
It's from Harvard.
Maybe it's more money.
Mm. We have been informed by Tau Kappa Gamma that your team delivers canned speeches. Arguments written by faculty rather than students. Therefore, we are changing the topic. You will have the same amount of time to write new arguments as the Harvard team, 48 hours.
Coaches help students all the time.
Yes, sir.
Both teams will be delivered the same reference books.
Yes, sir.
Our new topic resolved. Civil disobedience is a moral weapon in the fight for justice. While the college will be arguing the affirmative.
Thank you, sir. I can't reach Mr. Tolson. Nobody knows where he is.
Setting us up to lose.
We can't win without him.
You're wrong. We can't win without him.
Bro?
Under government which imprisons unjustly, the true place for a just.
Here's your coffee, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
Just Wilson.
Has provided.
Thank you, Wilson.
And less responding spirits.
Well, you have to use a mask word, Umbritone.
Agreed, James, but we'll save it for the rebuttal.
What?
We're gonna save the best for last. Because you have to leave the audience.
I think we should get into Gandhi's concept of satyagraha.
I don't agree. I don't think people can understand what satyagraha,
from the Sanskrit, meaning truth and fairness.
I told you,
It's obvious to me that we should begin the debate with Gandhi.
This is exactly why I won't do it. Why should I do the obvious
thing? Because that's what we're
doing. Listen to what you're saying. This is Harvard, okay? The first thing you think when you think civil disobedience
that's
is
why we
what?
Should
what's
use
the first
Gandhi.
Thing? What's
is
the first thing you
point.
Think? I mean, I want to win. Do you want to win?
Yes, I want to win.
Right.
Win.
I don't care. Right.
This is not getting us anywhere.
Me, I was in charge. He didn't put you in charge. He put you in charge. He put me in charge. Why did you make this decision? We're not starting with Gandhi. We're not starting with Gandhi.
Yes, we are not. You hear yourself. You sound like a kid.
Well, you are a kid.
Yes, you're an idiot. I'm an
idiot.
Yes, you're an idiot. Yes, you're an idiot.
To hell with you. To hell.
To hell with me. To hell with me.
Back, isn't he?
See if I care.
Beautiful when you sleep. Yeah, I know. She can't stop me from looking at you.
Can I shut up and go to bed?
James, come on, wake up.
No.
James? Come on, James, get up.
What? What is this?
That's my notes.
What are you giving them to me for?
Because you're debating, not me.
What?
It's your turn, James.
You serious? Crazy.
14, you're just as good as me. The judges will love you.
No, you can't quit.
I'm not quitting, Samantha. Tulsa made me captain, and he said you were ready.
Yeah, but you saw me at Howard. I was horrible.
That's right. You did terrible, didn't you? You stunk up the whole joint, right? So you should just quit, right? You should just give up? Who's the judge?
What?
Who's the judge?
Judge is God.
Why is he God?
he decides who wins or loses, not my opponent.
And who is your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
And why doesn't he exist?
Because he is a mere dissenting voice to the truth I speak.
That's right.
Direct from Harvard Memorial Hall in Cambridge, Massachusetts, this is WNBC Radio, bringing to you live tonight's history-making debate between Little Wiley College from Marshall, Texas, and the Harvard University debate team. The first time ever a Negro college has faced the national champions. Harvard's Dean of Students is making his way to the podium now. The crowd, as if on cue, falls silent.
On this historic occasion, we welcome the distinguished team from Wiley College, our illustrious judges, you the audience, and through the wonder of radio, the nation. Harvard University celebrates its 300th anniversary this year, and in Franklin Delano Roosevelt, its fifth president of the United States. But no university, no matter how grand or august in its history, can afford to live in the past. So, in the spirit of tomorrow, I introduce to you today the debaters from Wiley College, Ms. Samantha Book, Mr. James Farmer Jr. Mr. Farmer will argue the first affirmative.
Resolved. Civil disobedience is a moral weapon in the fight for justice. But how can disobedience ever be moral? Well, I guess that depends on one's definition of the words. Word. In 1919, in India, 10,000 people gathered in Amritsar to protest the tyranny of British rule.
Has it started?
Shh, your brother's talking. Just sit down.
General Reginald Dyer trapped them in a courtyard and ordered his troops to fire into the crowd for 10 minutes. 379 died. Men, women, children shot down in cold blood. Dyer said he had taught them a moral lesson. Gandhi and his followers responded not with violence, but with an organized campaign of non-cooperation. Government buildings were occupied. Streets were blocked with people who refused to rise, even when beaten by police. Gandhi was arrested, but the British were soon forced to release him. He called it a moral victory. The definition of moral, Dyer's lesson, or Gandhi's victory. You choose.
From 1914 to 1918, for every single minute, the world was at war. Four men laid down their lives. Just think of it. 240 brave young men were hurled into eternity every hour of every day of every night for four long years. 35,000 hours. 8,281,000 casualties. 240. Here was a slaughter immeasurably greater than what happened at Amritsar. Can there be anything moral about it? Nothing. Except that it stopped Germany from enslaving all of Europe. Civil disobedience isn't moral because it's nonviolent. Fighting for your country with violence can be deeply moral, demanding the greatest sacrifice of all, life itself. Nonviolence is the mask civil disobedience wears to conceal its true face. Anarchy.
Gandhi believes one must always act with love and respect for one's opponents, even if they are Harvard debaters. Gandhi also believes that lawbreakers must accept the legal consequences for their actions. Does that sound like anarchy? Civil disobedience is not something for us to fear. It is, after all, an American concept. You see, Gandhi draws his inspiration not from a Hindu scripture, but from Henry David Thoreau, who I believe graduated from Harvard and lived by a pond not too far from here.
My opponent is right about one thing. Thoreau was a Harvard grad, and like many of us, a bit self-righteous. He once said, any man more right than his neighbors constitutes a majority of one. Thoreau, the idealist, could never know that Adolf Hitler would agree with his words. The beauty and the burden of democracy is this. No idea prevails without the support of the majority. The people decide the moral issues of the day, not a majority of one.
Majorities do not decide what is right or wrong. Your conscience does. So why should a citizen surrender his or her conscience to a legislator? We must never, ever kneel down before the tyranny of a majority.
We can't decide which laws to obey and which to ignore. If we could, I'd never stop for a red light. My father is one of those men that stands between us and chaos. A police officer. I remember the day his partner, his best friend, was gunned down in the line of duty. Most vividly of all, I remember the expression on my dad's face. Nothing that erodes the rule of law can be moral, no matter what name we give it.
Why doesn't he say so?
Shh.
In Texas, they lynch Negroes. My teammates and I saw a man strung up by his neck and set on fire. We drove through a lynch mob, pressed our faces against the floorboard. I looked at my teammates. I saw the fear in their eyes. And worse, the shame. What was this Negro's crime that he should be hung without trial in a dark forest filled with fog? Was he a thief? Was he a killer? Or just a Negro? Was he a sharecropper? A preacher? Were his children waiting up for him? And who are we to just lie there and do nothing? No matter what he did, the mob was the criminal. But the law did nothing. Just left us wondering why. My opponent says, nothing that erodes the rule of law can be moral. But there is no rule of law in the Jim Crow South. Not when Negroes are denied housing, turned away from schools, hospitals, and not when we are lynched. St. Augustine said, an unjust law is no law at all. Which means I have a right, even a duty, to resist. With violence or civil disobedience. You should pray I choose the latter.
Tonight's debate between Harvard University and Wiley College. And the winner is
College. Thank you.